Morning.
Morning.
We need some 46 Mombasa Road to verse 3, then we come to verse 10. Let's pray. God is our refuge and strength, and ever present in every trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth give way, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains crack with their sighing. Verse 10. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Praise the Lord. Let's believe and pray. Father Almighty, we wish to come before you this morning. First of all, say thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for the gift of health, the Lord. Thank you for a wonderful week and the different things we've been able to do. Thank you for our children. Thank you, Father God, for the aspect of family. Thank you for all the disciples who are here and throughout the world, the Lord. Thank you for all the provisions that have come our way. Thank you for all the blessings that have come our way, the Lord. Father, we adore you. We glorify your name this morning. We know that you are the divinity, and that Father, you existed before any other one. The things you've done, we've read of them in the scriptures, in the Psalms, that have happened in our lives, or in the lives of those we know. Father, we exalt you, and we call your name now. We thank you because you are wonderful, and you are everlasting. Father, we know that if it were not for your Son to die for our sins, we will not be here this morning. And so we also want to appreciate the fact that your Son sacrificed and died for our sins this morning. Giving us a chance to be called disciples, to be called your Son and daughter. Forgive us, Jehovah Lord, because despite this, we continuously speak against you. We do things that are not in line with your will. Forgive us for our thoughts and evil. Forgive us for our thoughts and evil. Forgive us for our actions and evil. And forgive us because we fail to do the things you command us to do from your scriptures to your Lord. Pardon us, Jehovah Lord, as far as east is from the west. Wipe away our sins. And this morning, Father, we ask you to remember the portion of the Holy Spirit among us as Jehovah Lord. Among us, the church of Jehovah. The Holy Spirit to all who are gathered here this morning, Jehovah Lord. So that, Father, we may be able to be impacted by your Holy Spirit in a tremendous way. We want to pray that you need power a portion of your Holy Spirit to those who are going to be speaking before us, Jehovah Lord. The one that is going to be bringing the Holy Communion message, and the one that is going to be bringing the main message. Pour your Holy Spirit so that, Father, they will speak the words you've planted in their hearts, that they will be able to communicate to us what you want us to hear this morning. I want to pray for all of us, Jehovah Lord, that you will help us to open our hearts, to receive your word, and to be a lifted high because you are mighty and wonderful. I want to pray, Father, that Lord, please also be with the children as they get to learn with their Father. Impact them, Jehovah Lord, so that as they grow, that they will grow in your ways, Jehovah Lord. We pray for the teachers that are taking care of them, that Lord, dear Father, please inspire them so that they can be able to inspire the children. I know how hard it is to be with the children, but I pray that Lord, please give them a spirit of patience, a spirit of giving, Jehovah Lord, for the glory of your name. Help us to have a wonderful time as we worship you, as we praise you, as we listen to the word of your Father. We thank you, we love you, in Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, church. It's a great to be here. We want to thank God for the wonderful opportunity that He's given us this morning so that we may come and just get to worship God as we get to fellowship together. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome us once again to the house of the Lord. I don't know how the last week has been for you, but we know that we live in a challenging world. Could be some of us have gone through one or two things, but we thank God that He's given us yet another chance to come today and be able to start a new week. It is a privilege to be in the house of the Lord this morning. This is the Mombasa Christian Church. We are part of a bigger congregation worldwide, the ICOC family of churches. And so if you are visiting with us, please feel at church in among men and women who love God deeply. We are not perfect, but we are striving to make it to heaven, in hope that one day, one time, we will all be under His feet as we get eternal rest, but as also we get to worship God for eternity. So, karibuni sana. Now, today is a very special day, because I am not the one that is going to be preaching. We have a very, 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 very special man who is visiting with us today. And many of us know him, because this is the man who planted the church in Mombasa. Many of us maybe have been wondering, so how did this church start? Today you'll have a privilege to hear how this church all started. You know, there are stories you cannot tell, but if you have the person, then they can be able to tell you. And today, we have our brother Isaac Basweti. Isaac Basweti is visiting from Kisii. After leaving Mombasa, he went to Kisii. That is his hometown. And he said, I need to have a church in Kisii. And so he planted the church in Mombasa. He's gone ahead and planted the church in Kisii. And from Kisii, we have a church in Beka. We have a church in Migori, and you can see that this is a man who truly loves God. Amen. You know, I've seen many brothers, but I'm yet to find them. There are very few who are as passionate as Isaac is. Isaac is unstoppable. When he came here, he was the only disciple in Mombasa. And he had left Eldoret. I actually knew him when he was in Eldoret. And he said, you know what, I cannot come and keep this light for myself. And because of him, we are here today. Because of him, we have the church in belief. Can you imagine? If we only decided to keep quiet, then we will not have a church in Mombasa, we will not have a church in Kilibi, we don't have a church in Migori, we don't have a church in Isi, we don't have a church in Beka. Can you imagine? Those are how many congregations that has been planted as a result of just one man. Almost five. Can you imagine? So, that is the man that is going to be speaking to us today. So please join me as we welcome Isaac. Brothers and the sisters. And so we had to put that aside, because waheka walisema mgeni akuje wenyeji wapone, sivyo? Kwa leo tutapata ukunyani. So we will have that devotional next week. Please bear with us. I know that there is some message that has been cooked, and it's like it's now being overcooked, but we hope that it's still going to pass across. So next week we'll have our devotional, the brothers and the sisters separately. Promises to be a great day. But today, please open our hearts and let's listen to Isaac to pass with you.
Mike happens to be one of my teachers. I really appreciate him a lot, and he's been teaching us many things. It's not easy for you to speak to your teacher. Najua walimu wanakuwa mbele ya wanafunzi, sio? So before you, a word comes from your mouth, the teacher knows that this guy is headed somewhere. But it's a privilege and honor for him to have given me this chance. I was just wondering, what can I share in Mombasa Church? Mombasa, I know when I left this place, some of my friends from Nairobi say, you are one of the people we least expected to leave Mombasa. Why? Because I stayed in Mombasa for 16 years. In 1994, when I finished college, I came to Mombasa. And due to persecution in 1997, towards the close of 1997 and the start of 1998, I had to move to Eldoret. I had a serious persecution here in Mombasa, and I left for Eldoret to find a safe place for me and my family. And when I went there, I found disciples. And in 1998, with Wanane, I got baptized. I reached out by Agre Azerwa, and I was baptized by Julius Mbuku at Siripua Hotel. And things did work in Eldoret. In 1999, they closed quarters. From 1999, life was hard. My business just came down. I didn't have anything to do. Didn't have what to support my family with. And I had a loan that was accumulating in the banks. So I decided to move back to Mombasa in 1999, December. So the year 2000, I found myself in Mombasa struggling to make my ends meet. And as I was saying, life was hard because at one point, every month, the guys who had my loan, the loan I took of 160,000, they had accumulated to 900,000. So every month they would come to my house, wakipata anything, they sweep and go with it. Wanangojea tarehe 12 ya next month. Life was hard. We got the story short. Anyway, I had to maintain my relationship. Regardless of that, God helped me that I had to maintain my relationship with God. I really appreciate the brothers from Nairobi who encouraged me, and one of the brothers from Eldoret, Agre Azerwa, who used to come like every month to come and see me and encourage me. Julius Mbuku, they used to come to Mombasa and encourage me. I remember Mary Gitao, Mel Bolton, they used to come visit us. We used to have a house church, very small house, and they told their Mombasa and they go. Love your visitors, like 7 visitors. Wengine wamekaa kwa kitanda, wengine kwa kiti nilikuwa nacho hivi. But anyway, the service used to happen. And I really thank God for this service. I appreciate you guys. I love your singing. And when you were singing, I remember when you were putting down a few things about the Basweti Church. You like me to tell you about Basweti Church?
Yes.
We are yet to launch our church in Kisi, and the date was to be towards the end of this year. But up to now, we have not gotten the date clear, but we hope that the church will be launched very soon. And when you were singing, I just thought, like, you know, these are the guys I'm going to give number one priority to be singing on that particular day. Hi. That way, just be prepare your songs well and know that you've given the priority. Is the church has three Bible talks, as you have heard from our evangelist. We have the history itself, we have the Asumi or Rebecca, which is led by Elias and Maggie, but it used to be led by the brother who passed on, Onduru, and his wife Pixis. And we have Migori, which is being led by Julius Achacha. Julius Achacha is a fruit from Kisi Church. And we have Jacob Owiti. They are assisting one another to lead the church there. The church has been in existence since April 2013. So it's like, we are almost like 10 years now. Started from a house church. As usual, our churches, we start from the houses. So, ukiona Bible talk inafanyika kwa nyumba yako, hiyo ni kanisa tayari. And there is a way that God changes that status to a church where people can come and it's being launched. And that in the year 2014, we moved, and just a good friend of mine, an Indian, gave us his own school for free and chairs and said, you guys come and have a church here. We stayed there for a good number of years until 2020 when we moved to a hotel that we went through a lot of persecution. Mahali tukaenda tunapata kanisa imefungwa, hall imefungwa, we have to look for the man in charge. We went through a lot. And after that we moved to another premise that was like a school. At the same time also we had a lot of persecution. Napata geti imefungwa, kuna mwenyewe, ameenda kanisa kwako. We have to look for him. So we thank God that now we are at a place called the Elliot Learning Center. It's just near town. You can just walk from town and get to church. So when you come to PC, just to visit the Elliot Learning Center, that's where we worship. And our prayer is that we manage to have a place a sanctuary. We thank God, one of our Bible talks, tumefaulu kununua shamba for one of our Bible talks, that's Becca. We have a good shamba. We are looking forward to build a sanctuary. So what has been Kisi doing? Kisi has been doing many things, and this includes saving souls. We have had young people, all the people getting baptized, and continuously we have been seated that to discover the talents of many people, young, and all the people are serving, especially in the choir. They never knew that they could sing. They never knew that they could even play people. But we thank God that through that we have been able to get people who are involved to make our services great. And also supporting the marriage ministry. That one we just have a powerful group called Our Couples that has been able to save. You know what? The word save in a marriage. God has helped us that we have saved two marriages that are already separated. And the children were at a crossroads. But now they are happily together. And two of the couples are studying the Bible. One of the couple is leader in one of their titles. They are leaders. But we thank God that through that ministry, we have been able to do a lot and also encourage married couples to stay together, to do parenting together. And then whenever we have these classes on East African marriage, they usually attend. They did appreciate that. Just to mention a few, those are some of the few things that the Kisi Church is doing. And our expectation is for the launch of this church as soon as possible. And another thing is we really need an intern or a full-time minister because of the workload that is in that in the church. We have many young people, our campus ministry is doing well, and we thank God because one of the campus ministry guys is one of the people that was selected. Out of the seven, we had one from East, will bring a missionary, the BIM. You call it BIM mission? School.
Yes,
mission school. Yeah, and our prayer is that we have a place, as I've said, and also continue to strengthen the parent ministry in that place. And one of the reasons is, that's why I'm here today. This church is our mother church. If you hear Kisi, you hear Migori, you hear Mecca, you know those are your sons and daughters. So if there is anything that that church has to achieve, he has to have the blessings of the Father. And that's the Pastor Church. So I just want to request that you walk with us this journey at the launch of that church. We'll come, we'll give you the proposals that we have and the needs of the church so that you can assist. Mtoto anapewa sufuria alafu anaenda kukipikia sufuria. Eh? Akikuwa mtu mkubwa, mama anasema kwa hii sufuria, sahani na kijiko, ende aanze nyumba, si ndivyo? And I didn't expect you guys to do that for us because imekuwa wakubwa. So we learn these things from our daily lives. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, dear God, it's a great morning that you have allowed us to meet here. Thank you for this church. God, you have been faithful all these years since God planted a seed in this region. We thank you for the church in Philippi and the disciples there, God. We thank you for these ones who have remained faithful to you all this time, God, they have been serving you. We know it has not been easy for all of them. But God, as you promised the scriptures in Matthew 28, that you'll be with us until the end of the age, I want to thank you for keeping your promise. Thank you so much this morning that you have allowed me to share my life with these brothers and sisters. I pray that God, you are going to speak to each one's heart. Speak to us, God, that we may be able to be there for you because you are always there for us. Use me, God, I know I'm not worthy to speak, God. It's better to stand in front of your faithful God. But I pray that you use me as a vessel to speak that which you want us to hear today. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Until we see God in those situations of our life,
then we'll not be able to appreciate it. I want to share with us about resilience. What is resilience? Resilience. When you say someone is resilient, what's the meaning? The greatest men and women of the Bible were not super people. They were not people from another planet. But they had great resilience. If you are a resilient person, it means that you are a person with an ability to bounce back from defeats, from discouragements, from hardships. You can bounce back. You are not a man or a woman who is, when beaten, stays down there. You are a man or a woman who dusts themselves and they keep moving. You don't stay there. You are a man who does not look at what brought them down. You are a man who looks at what will take you up. When I think of the people who are most admirable in our society, or even the political arena, resilience always comes to my mind. In the political world, we have people are resilient. In the world, even the current president is a resilient man, you guys can say. How many times is he been put down? But he stays strong. He says, he goes. And he doesn't care what is going to happen. We have very many men and women who never say die. Never say die. They don't say this is all. These people believe God's promises regardless of the circumstances that surround them. They always remember that God, you promise you'll be with me until the end of the age. So what happens? Now that I'm here, I still start and go. I still wake up and start another day. They are filled with an overcoming attitude that expects God to use them regardless of their handicaps. The attitude that, you know what? Regardless of this, God is going to use me for his great purpose. It's that day. I was going through a lot, and when that institution is called KIE, Kenya Industrial Estate, when they say, you know what, enough is enough, now you are not able to pay this money, what will we do? I remember that day I was walking in Rikwana Pau for Karibuna Junction, Yamakupa, Kotini. You remember the place. And I felt like I cannot stay. My workshop is going to be full, and my nyumba, because I'm still a parent. And the only place that was open was my house. Nasikwa Nakana, the girl. You come at the Nakana, but I was born at the bar, somebody. And I decided to go to the house. I was walking, I walked from Moyamen, and I was walking to the house. I was walking to the couple of feet roundabout, I was on the left side. And I decided now the best thing to do nikiwa na nakuvuka barabara nikasema sasa hii maneno yote ni ya kazi gani napitia. Nikitiko confused kwa hii barabara tu sitarongwa na gari na hii maneno yataisha yote. Akili ingine kaniambia, no, remember your mom. I used to love my mom so much. My mom passed away from the city. And she used to encourage me. When I was having that loan, she tried to raise money to find a fundraising and go. At least to find a person to repay your own in the money. But guys didn't give any money. So I said, Mama, sasa nitamwambia nini. Then nikavuka barabara, nikafika katikati, kuna barabara this side and this side. So there is a walkway hapa katikati. Then I remember, hey, there's this brother called Epino Mai. I called him, nikiwa hapo, nikitembea hapo katikati. He told me, you know what? You are supposed to do what is right. God will just answer your prayers. Just go and talk to someone. And I said, okay, I think that's the best thing I can do. That's the best thing I can do. Now, I felt like, instead of going to the house, I just after my exemplar. And that's when I shared the problem with my exemplar. Something came up. The guy who guaranteed me the loan had received a message about his items being taken away. Alikuwa ameweka nyumba yake uzuri. So this guy called me, akakuja down na akaniambia, you know what? I want us to sit down and see what is to happen. And we talked, we went back to the institution, wakasema, we are going to give you a waiver, pay 300,000 for it. Out of the 900,000. I didn't believe my case. And the guy told me, I'm going to give you 150,000. They remained there. They also believe that God is might, power, working through them, enables them to do everything God asks them to do with the help of Christ, who has given them the strength. They believe that God is there. God will always provide a way out. I don't know. Today, at what point you felt like you want to leave church? How many of us have ever felt like I want to leave church? Just be honest. Yes. That is very normal. If you have never felt like so, then you have not gotten challenges that challenge your faith. That is very normal. I'm going to share examples of a few people in the Bible who underwent the same kind of situations. It's very normal to feel like that. Why? Because the evil one wants to make sure that you fail in the blood that God has for you. But the moment you realize that God has promised that you'll be with me until the end of the age, God is there, is in fact, I'm here because of God, then that will help you. Among those of us who have confessed, who have said that there's a time in their life they have felt like they want to leave God. I know it did not just come. There were driving forces, discouragements, issues in your life that made you to come to that conclusion. At the same time, the Spirit of God speaks to us when we are in that situation. There's a way that God talks to us in regard to what we are going through. At this point, Paul would have felt like, you know what? The opposition in this town is too much. Now that these guys have been saved, they have accepted Jesus, these guys are not going to let me. In the way we're dying. But he listened to another voice that told him, do not be afraid, but speak and do not be silent. These are the words. I'm at the reasoning, thinking of to resilient people. You are not stopped by the circumstances that are around you. No. You are driven by the power that God has given you. There's something that happened to one of the men that you always learn the Bible when it comes to hard times. What's the name of this man who went through a lot in his life? The Bible.
Job.
The Old Testament. Job. You guys know the story of Job?
Yes.
Yes. Job went through a lot. He lost his family. He lost everything that he had. And he was sick. Let's read Job 42. Says, also verse 1 and 2, then Job prayed right to the Lord, I know that you can do anything and no plan of yours can be further. That's a man who has come to realize who God is. There's a time recently we went to a funeral in Nakuru. And there's a time came when the pastor was supposed to speak. And this pastor stood and asked all the pastors that are trained to come in front. But at all, all the Makuja then, and they were over 15. And he said, this death that happened in this family is not from God. There are deaths that are from the devil. I kept wondering, what message is that? This is happening to the family because the devil has decided to finish this family. I have not seen this in the Bible. And what I know in the Bible is that God knows everything. There's nothing that takes God by surprise. If God wants you to live, you live. If God wants you to depart from this earth, you'll allow it to happen. So the devil cannot have power to take the lives of people. What about the book of God? Mtu amekuwa mgonjwa na amekufa, hiyo ugonjwa ndiyo suddenly God was around it happened. We lost our brother in the back of the road. It was so hard for us. Especially me. Why? Because I saw that brother die at 2 in the morning. Because I was there from Sasita and we tried to help him from the doctors. I was helpless. In fact, less than 5 minutes before he passed on, we were talking. What am I getting? And I knew that Bibi yangu amefika na mambia anakuja. Bibi yangu amefika na mambia anakuja tu. Wako njiani. Because walikuwa natoka mbali. And I knew nipeleke nje. Nipeleke nje. Narudi. The last time, tulirudi. Nilimsaidia na nevi wake. Nasimama tu, ingia kwa kitanda, ni less than 1 minute. The brother passed on. Na nikasema, if God wanted that brother to live more than that cycle, angeishi. Kwa sababu then, zile vitu waliwekewa za kumsaidia brain, alisema asimsaidia. He's having difficulty in breathing. So oxygen was more than that. If God wanted the brother to live, I'm sharing this because when we go through things in life, the confidence we need to have is that God is with us and God knows understands everything. And I know why you're going through that. So we need to remain focused in what in our relationship with God. In the book of 2 Peter chapter 1:3, You can read, therefore, His divine power has given us everything required for life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. These are words that came from Peter. You know who Peter was? You remember Peter, the story of Peter with Jesus? God has said, okay, when we are learning about disciples, Peter is working very well. You know what? Yeah. At a car, anything happened, I'm young. He used to be like that. But when he talks in this scripture, in this book, 2 Peter, he says, for this divine power has given us everything required for life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and the goodness. He had evidenced great resilience after struggling many times in Jesus' ministry, with great shame in the eyes of many. You remember the time he said to Jesus, you know what? That I'll go with you. Then I know it's a man. He said, I'm going to be away from you. You are going to deny me 3 times. And this man, when he was faced by that Sabbath guy, he said, I don't know. I don't know what they're talking about. Remember the time Jesus told him to get behind me, Satan? Yes. So he came to a point now, saying, you know what? This has happened. He says, this divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. When we know Christ, we become mindful of His abilities to deliver us from any discouragement. I want to call us today to want to know God. Just know God. Learn more who God is. Just get your Bible and learn who God is. You'll see. He'll create in you the stamina for you to overcome many challenges in your life. Love God will keep you moving. It will help you to overcome, not to see problems be more bigger than who God is. So this calls us for how is your Bible study? How are you committed to your relationship with God? When you are committed, it will help you to remain serious. When you look at perfect example we have for resilience, is Jesus Christ. He does good things, he pursues it. Up to the cross, but he did not stop there. When he rose from the dead, he followed his disciples to make sure that what he came to do, he has achieved. Are we people who drop at some point? In Matthew 28, verse 19 to 20, shows how resilient our Lord Jesus was. Shows us that, you know what? He wanted to achieve the goal of saving mankind. And that's what he did. The question is, are we people who start and stop at some point? Or people start, and when they find it's hard, they find a better way of doing it. They look for a better way of doing it. Or we are people who remain faithful to the end. And that is what Jesus did. He was resilient until he achieved this goal. We need to remain resilient until we achieve the goal of making it to heaven. In the book of 2 Timothy 4, verse 9, says, go therefore and make disciples of our nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. No. 2 Timothy 1, 2 Timothy 1. Are we there? verse 9. Make everyone to come to me soon, for Demas has deserted me because he loved this present world and has gone to Thessalonica. Presence has gone to Galatia. Let us do that matter. Only Luke is with me. Please mark with you, for he is useful to me in the ministry. Absent, take us to Ephesus. Paul was saying that Demas has deserted me because he loved this world. It's a man who was not in Syria. It's a man who could not stay. People have grown up. No doubt there, but even in this church, people have become demons. Probably not wrong. Many. This week I was just going through my diary, and I saw where we had written the settling grief for the church. Remember what we used to have the settling grief? The sisters record who you are. So I had my their brothers. And in that assembly, it was so big. But I'm seeing a few brothers here. Others have dropped off. Others have moved to other churches. We have so many members in our church or in our society. People will not be able to remain resilient until the end. Maybe because of the love of the world, or maybe just because of becoming weak, deciding not to work hard, because Christianity is working hard. There is no relationship that is easy to keep. Marriage. Am I speaking sense? Is there marriage that is easy to keep? There is it. There must be hard work. So any relationship is hard work from both parties. And our relationship with God is the same. There must be hard work for us to maintain a relationship. Otherwise, we'll choose the less traveled road. We choose the road that is traveled by men, not less. The less traveled road is the one that is hard. But the road that is traveled by many people is easier. And that's the kind of Christianity people are yearning for. People are yearning for Christianity that comes at a time that is convenient. But we need to remain strong and true to God's word. The book of 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. I like us to show resilience like him. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. You need to remain resilient in your speech, in love, in faith, in purity. So many young people fail to show an ability to recover from the put downs of their peers. In these areas of purity, the areas of faith, areas of love, the areas of speech. When they go down, they are not able to come up again. I want to encourage young people here, because I like the way Polycarp when Polycarp was coming up, I think Polycarp came to this town without knowing what they can see. He didn't know what they can see. It's not any charge that in fact it was the need of the hour that we needed someone to do what? To see. I remember the day of the launch of the church in Mombasa, the guy he had planned so well to come and see, to lead the singing, was so powerful. That guy was powerful. I was with him in college, He was in college. I reached out to him, he became a disciple. He married in an endowed powerfully in church. And the day that the launch of the church in Mombasa was to happen, we had practiced songs the previous day, that's on Saturday. But he didn't turn up on Sunday. He didn't turn up. Something happened just that night, and I didn't show up. Up to this day, he has never shown up. I don't know which church will lodge for him to come so that he can participate. I usually talk to him, but he has never come. He was a young and vibrant soul leader. He was very, let me just say, he was not the resilient. How many things have tried to put you down as a young man? Just when you get yourself to that position, remind yourself that you need to be resilient. You need to overcome that and move on with your Christian life. I know he regrets this because his life has never been the same. Life outside the kingdom of God is difficult. You cannot only pretend, but it's difficult. You need to have a relationship with God. We need to be sure that, let me read this statement. So many young people fail to show an ability to recover from the put downs of their peers in these areas of speech, love, faith, purity. You can do it by making a decision to be resilient like Jesus Christ, like Paul, like John, like Peter, like Caleb, like Joshua, like Gideon, and many more men and women that you can see in the Bible. It's just that decision. You decide, you know what? There are so many discouragements, but I'm going to stand up and go on. Discipling is key. In your resilience. If you are a disciple and you are not being discipled, remember that in resilience will be a far thing from you. Why? Because life has challenges. Embrace discipline. Look for it. Embrace your word, your knowledge of God's word and application of it. Not just knowledge, but application of it. Fight it. On your own. Don't just say that, you know what, these guys are not caring about me. It's your life, it's your relationship with God, and no one else. Our evangelist might not be following you, even, you know, sometimes. I look at the brothers who left, who are brought. They were running away from us. And those who manage to come back, they are very strong. And they remain resilient up to this day. It's my prayer that all of us will look at a relationship with God in a very positive way. Something that belongs to you as a person. It's your responsibility. And that will help you to remain resilient. My prayer for this church is that may the Lord strengthen your faith in Him. May the Lord bless your children and protect them whenever they go out and whenever they come back. May the Lord bless the work of your hands. Whatever you lay your hands on, let it be a blessing. I also pray that may you be a blessing. All those who come to you for help, for direction. Because they will always come. The Lord will add to your number in Jesus' name.
Wow, wasn't that a powerful message? Wasn't that great?
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Brother Isaac, for that message. Indeed, today you shared with us the secret. You know, many of us have been wondering, what is it that keeps this brother going? How has he been able to go through? I know those of us who know Isaac, he's just shared with us a very small tip of his life. But if you look at his life, if you have fellowship with him, his life is full of resilience. He's gone through, what he shared is just a very small portion of his life. But if there is one man I know that has been fruitful in God's kingdom, it's Isaac. Because of that resilience. You know, many of us, when we signed up to become disciples, we actually thought that the moment I become a disciple, that would be the end of all my problems and the end of all my troubles. But what Isaac is telling us that no, and that's the same message Jesus preached and saying in this world you have many troubles. From the days of John the Baptist to now, the kingdom of God has gone through so much and will continue to go through so much. But it's the forceful men that have it. The men and women who are resilient. And that is the message today. That we can never give up on this journey. There are many things that keep those of us who signed up to be disciples. There are many things that keep disturbing us, bringing us down. But as I use the words of Isaac, saying, we have the disciples who have the ability to dust off, stand up, and continue. And indeed, that is what is going to help us to make it to the very end. And so, I don't know that this message can be seen. Some of us, it's really going to be at a point where we are making decisions. And among the decisions we are contemplating is to let go and say, I am tired. I hope and pray that you be encouraged this morning to realize that regardless of the challenges of this life, we still have to continue and we still have to keep on going. Because God is watching and He is looking for us. And He said that we should draw closer to Him. He will draw closer to us. He is waiting to fight the battle with us. He's saying he's seen God, and how I pray that even us, as we get through our lives, that we see God, because there is so much that God has done in our lives. And so Isaac, thank you so much. Thank you for the great work that you are doing in God's kingdom. Isaac has never been in full-time ministry, but he is a full-time minister. With all his challenges, he loves God deeply, and that is what keeps him going from time to time. So thank you so much, bro, for that heart of inspiring and preaching the word of God and making the decision that you are not going to keep quiet. Either this one man, you will drop him anywhere, you just know that he will start a church and the church will continue going on. Because it's strong to believe that He is the light of the world, and whatever He has, that light has to shine. And that is the great thing that personally I am learning from Him, and I would want to continue to imitate in His life, that it is time to move, it is time to preach the word of the Lord, it is time to just walk out, share your faith, and be resilient. When those things come, dust from the dust, and move on. Because God is waiting on the other hand. Let's put our hands together once more. Now, as I had shared earlier, I believe in the previous services, that we are going to be having our special contribution at the end of August. And so right now, we want us to start making and working ways on how to be able to go extra mile to be able to collect the special fund that is going to help our church move on financially. We've been stuck for quite some time now because we do not have the finances to keep us going as a church, not just in Mombasa, but across East Africa. And so across East Africa, there are a lot of people, I think they were having their fundraising. They are having their fundraising. Across East Africa, we are also encouraging our churches to do their special collections to be able to boost our church so that the gospel does not stop on account of finances. And so, brothers and sisters, this is something we should put in our hearts. This is something we should be praying about so that we can be able to give this special contribution that we go and advance God's kingdom. So I pray that we will be working on it and that we are going to be doing whatever it is or whatever it takes so that we can improve our contribution. Next week we are going to have a devotional for the brothers and sisters. And so we come all together, have our communion, and then after the communion we will separate the brothers and the sisters separately. We will have that special devotional for the brothers. So let's come and have a prayer. Let's also go ahead and invite our friends because people are waiting to listen and hear from God's heart. Amen. Mubashira, can you confirm the things of the Father special presentation? I don't know whether they are ready for it. Almighty Father, thank you this afternoon. We are glad for the message that you've spoken to us. Indeed, Isaac has been such an inspiration to the saints across East Africa because of his resilience in the words, in the things of God. Thank you so much, God Father, for giving us a man who is so passionate about you. A man who goes everywhere and he can't keep quiet. He speaks the gospel to men and women in hope that they will turn around and follow him. Thank you. Because we know as a result of him, we have the church. As a result of him, we have the church. We have the church in Beka, in Migori. And we know there are many more churches that are going to be planted because of the resilient men and women like you. Thank you for the inspiration. I know that the Savior will be traveling this afternoon back to PC. We want to put his journey before you, that God, you may give him a safe journey. Father, we want to remember our sister, the minister, the Savior, for an operation tomorrow. We also beg God to be with her. We pray that God will go ahead of us. That means the doctors, the nurses, everybody else is going to be involved in that operation, be in their right frame of mind, that they're not going to have any human mistakes, that everything is going to go as scheduled to the glory of your name. I pray that you will give us courage, because we know that operations are not one of those easy things, though. It takes a lot. So we pray that, Father, you strengthen her. Help her to remember that she is not alone. You tell us that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that Father, you are with us and you will be with us. We pray for our sister to Easter that you will be with us. That tomorrow is going to be a great success because you live. Thank you so much for all of us, God. I also pray for our brothers and sisters, even in this congregation, could be some of us are going through one or two things that are challenging. Sometimes our faith are being tested. Sometimes we are being tempted to give up. May you be with us. Those who are looking into the scriptures, Father, we pray that they will make the decision to choose you as Lord and Savior of their lives. Because that is why you came. That you may have life in you and have that life in abundance. We remember our children, we also pray that we will be with them as we grow up in this corrupt generation. And Father, you are going to plant in their hearts to remember the great and awesome thing that you did, that you are doing, and that you are yet to do. Be with our child, bless our child, as we hear towards special contribution across East Africa. We pray that, Lord, you are going to work in our hearts to be willing to give to you. Thank you, my Lord. Be with us, Lord. Give us a great time. In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen. 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 Are the kids ready? Or we'll have it another time.
Please. going the same road. When he saw the body, he passed the other direction. A Levite, while passing, he saw the man and he went the other direction. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, he came where the man was. He took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wound, pouring oil and wine. He then put the man on his own donkey and went. He went to the innkeeper. He took him there. The man took two denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. The Samaritan went, leaving the body with the innkeeper. The next day, he came back to the innkeeper.
Enjoy and be looking forward to that beautiful day. Amen.
Amen.
Sikuriwana.